The dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural.
Is it possible to learn this power?
Not from a Jedi.
Time to conclude the Star Wars prequel retrospective with the high point of the trilogy, Revenge of the Sith.
This is where the fun begins.
Episode 3 still has some jokes that don't land and some over-the-top action beats, but it's the closest the prequels ever got to matching the greatness of the original trilogy. It's the most action-packed prequel movie, the most emotionally engaging prequel movie, the most mature Star Wars movie since The Empire Strikes Back, and it brings the trilogy to a perfect conclusion that both wraps up the prequel narrative and tees up the OT narrative.
I have brought peace, freedom, justice, and security to my new empire.
Your new empire?
When you watch the prequels back to back, you can really notice how much George Lucas's CGI technologies improved over the 7 or 8 years they were making these movies. The opening shot of Revenge of the Sith is mind-blowing. One of the dead giveaways of CG shots in the other prequels is the camera movements. If the pans and zooms are programmed to be perfectly smooth, then it won't create the illusion that it's being shot on a camera by human hands, and that illusion is a big part of the immersion. The camera in Revenge of the Sith's opening space battle moves realistically. The hypothetical camera operator scrambles to figure out which way is up, let alone keep track of Anakin and Obi-Wan's starfighters. This dazzling camera work plunges you right into the middle of the spacebound skirmish. The opening rescue sequence is like its own little Clone Wars episode that reintroduces the characters, re-establishes their dynamics, and sets the stage for the rest of the movie. Lucas tells you early on that Revenge of the Sith is going to be a lot darker and more uncompromising in its portrayal of Anakin's descent to the dark side, with his ruthless decapitation of Count Dooku. Anakin decapitates Dooku because Palpatine tells him to.
Do it.
Reaffirming his puppet master status. But the really shocking part is that Anakin didn't just kill Dooku because Palpatine told him to. He wanted to do it, even though he knew it was wrong.
I shouldn't have done that. It's not the Jedi way.
The audience went in knowing Anakin would be Darth Vader by the end of the film. So Lucas didn't bother with ambiguity. He tells you up front that Anakin is a cold-hearted killer and there's no changing his fate. And because you've got the great Christopher Lee playing Dooku, you can really see the look of horror in his eyes when he looks up at the man he knows as his mentor Darth Sidious, and realizes in his final moments that he was just an expendable pawn in Sidious's rise to power.
Do it.
One of the things I really don't like about Revenge of the Sith, one of the very few things, is the way it sidelines Padme. She was a part of all the major action sequences in the first two prequels, but she just mopes around her apartment being pregnant in Episode 3. I get that she needed to be pregnant for the birth of Luke and Leia, but she could have had more of a character arc besides just being pregnant. Give her a gun, let her fight some bad guys.
How was that?
Not bad.
Not bad for a girl.
Hey, that was pretty good for Rambo.
Revenge of the Sith does a great job of showing the Jedi's role in Anakin's downfall. Palpatine is the evil puppet master who draws Anakin to the Sith, but he might not have taken the bait if Mace Windu and the Council hadn't continually undervalued him.
This is outrageous. It's unfair. How can you be on the Council and not be a master?
Episode 3 sends Obi-Wan on another arbitrary B-plot adventure.
Hello there.
But this Obi-Wan B-plot is more successful than the one in Attack of the Clones because A, it has General Grievous, and B, it serves an important purpose in the overall story. If Obi-Wan was on Coruscant, he could have saved Anakin from Palpatine's influence. But because he's off-world on a business trip, Obi-Wan doesn't even realize anything's wrong until Anakin has already slaughtered children and he's way too far gone to be saved.
Not even the younglings survived.
Ewan McGregor is effortlessly charismatic as usual, and Hayden Christensen gives a much more nuanced portrayal of Anakin this time around, but Ian McDiarmid steals the show with an incredible performance as the soon-to-be Emperor. He nails the campness of the Chancellor Palpatine facade and the Phantom Menace of the Darth Sidious persona. He's like the Saul Goodman of a galaxy far, far away, a man with many faces. Some of the most memed moments in the movie are when his two personas meet.
I am the Senate.
I don't mind the scene where Palpatine effortlessly defeats some of the most elite warriors in the whole Jedi Order. One way to look at it is that it makes Kit Fisto and company look really weak, but another way to look at it is that it makes Palpatine look appropriately powerful.
Execute Order 66.
The purge montage always hits pretty hard. There's a tragic irony in the soldiers who were assigned to protect the Jedi being reassigned to kill them at the drop of a dime. The fact that Yoda can feel their pain in one fell swoop is heartbreaking.
I felt a great disturbance in the Force, as if millions of voices suddenly cried out in terror and were suddenly silenced.
And then he immediately goes back to badass Yoda mode when he anticipates a similar attempt on his own life.
I will do what I must.
You will try.
The climactic duel perfectly captures the death of Anakin and Obi-Wan's brotherhood. John Williams' piece Battle of the Heroes is second only to Duel of the Fates in terms of evoking the emotions of a lightsaber duel. The Mustafar setting is not only visually stunning, the big bursts of molten lava are the perfect symbolic backdrop for the explosive feelings of love and hate and resentment between these two bitter brothers. Some of the dialogue is a bit goofy.
It's over, Anakin! I have the high ground!
But McGregor and Christensen nail the fiery emotions of Obi-Wan and Anakin's final showdown.
You were my brother, Anakin! I loved you!
The Vader transformation scene is incredible. You know, minus the no. This moment is what the whole trilogy was working towards, and it manages to live up to the hype. It's a deeply unsettling sequence. You can really feel Anakin's pain as his scorched skin is encased in the robotic suit that will torture him for the rest of his life. The last shred of Anakin's humanity is sealed away with the sound of the mask attaching to his face. The Star Wars prequel trilogy isn't perfect, far from it.
I don't like sand.
But it does have a perfect ending thanks to Revenge of the Sith. This is what happens when you know where your trilogy is going from the beginning and spend all three movies building up to the grand finale. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you liked the video. Remember to like and subscribe and click on the little bell. And also seize the day and call your mom and be kind to yourself.